because money has to reside somewhere. It has to flow. If water doesn't flow, it becomes stagnant. If blood doesn't flow through our bodies, we die. Motion is the law of God with money as well. Is money has to flow.
Hey, everybody, and welcome. It is Wednesday, and as you know, Wednesday is when you get to spend 30 minutes with your favorite host, Andrew Dupuy. It's Leaders Talk, and today on Leaders Talk, I am very happy to have with me Jim Oliver. Now, Jim is really interesting. Jim is the world's foremost authority on the infinite banking concept, and so he's dedicated his career to breaking the financial shackles that bind people and the businesses to unnecessary taxes and interest expenses. Jim spent 12 years under the tutelage of the late Nelson Nash, a pioneer of IBC, and now spreads the message of IBC through his firm, Create Tailwind. And his podcast, Breaking Wealth, talks about speaking engagements and gets in speaking engagements across the United States. Jim, welcome. You have a lot more of that to share with us here today, but let's go ahead and start out. Tell us a little bit about what the infinite banking concept is.
Yeah, you know, thank you, Andrew, and thank you for having me. The infinite banking concept, in a nutshell, is solving one problem that we have. And the problem we have is that we finance every single thing that we buy. We either pay interest or we give up interest we could have earned, right? In the infinite banking system, the way that a lot of people teach it is, hey, I'll finance my cars, I'll finance my vacations, I'll recapture interest that I would have paid somebody else, recapture lost opportunity cost. And I call that kind of infinite banking 101. Gotcha. It works for the average common person. It's great. But then there's the people that realize that, hey, we have a bigger problem. Is I'm exchanging time for money if I'm the average person out there working a 9 to 5, or even if I'm a business owner or I'm a doc or whatever it is, I'm exchanging time for money. Right. And I'm not buying assets to provide my ideal standard of living, making me financially free. The infinite banking system is a way to build a system to buy assets, to flow money back into a tax shelter, rinse and repeat over and over again, and have guaranteed growth in your money pool and tax in a tax invisible environment.
So what are some of the ways in which you suggest that people perform this operation to actually get this going and do it?
Yeah. So think of it like this, maybe like a ledger. So you, and I'm going to do the ledger backwards for any accounting majors out there, because this is a different way of thinking. So we're going to put the asset on the left. That's the insurance contract. When I put money in an insurance contract, and I have people that are putting hundreds of thousands of dollars, or I have people putting millions of dollars into their insurance contract. When I put $1 million in my insurance contract, the insurance company has to give me a loan, interest only, not of my money, of their money. My money stays in that tax shelter and grows every single day, guaranteed. They have to give me an interest only loan. So Andrew, it's kind of like this. I like to think of it like this. If I would loan you $100 million today, and your only obligation was to pay me $5 million of interest 1 year from today, would you take the loan?
Well, only $5 million in interest, $100 million? Yeah, clearly.
Right? And so, okay. So I love that you said yes, because if somebody says, well, I don't know, they don't know what to do with the money. But let's say that you made me that offer. And Andrew, if you do want to make me that offer, we can talk after the show. So you're going to loan me $100 million. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go get a seller of a portfolio or the bank to give me another $400 million, 80% loan to value. And I'm going to go buy $500 million of real estate.
Yeah.
Now, when I buy real estate, I'm normally around 40% cash on cash, but I'm going to say 25. Okay. Cause I want this to be conservative. So on your $100 million that you gave me that I have in the deal, or that you loaned me that I have in the deal, I'm going to make $25 million. Mm-hmm. And in a year, I mean, over that year, then I'm going to call you and I'm going to say, hey, Andrew, I have your interest check. I'd love to fly up from Florida and give you your check in person and buy you dinner. Yeah. So I hand you the check and you say, hey, Jim, do you want to pay any principal? And I say, nope, see you next year. Right? That's the kind of loan that we get from the insurance company. Okay, so we're going to do the same thing, probably not with 100 million, because it takes a little bit of time to get 100 million into an insurance contract.
Right.
Or, but let's say it's 100,000, let's say it's a million, whatever it is. I'm going to go take that money and I'm going to put it in cash flowing assets. Now, for me personally, I've bought over 30 businesses doing this. I use it for real estate. And when by the way, real estate is a business. You're not a real estate investor. You're in the real estate business. And it could be storage. It could be RV parks. It could be build to rent. It could be whatever thing, whatever sector you want to be in. It could be passive. I could give it to somebody who's going to go invest the money for me and I'm going to get 12 to 15%. I can make that work too with infinite banking system, whatever cash flowing asset that we do, because now we're controlling the banking function, right?
Yeah.
The insurance company doesn't ask us to apply for the loan. They have to give us the loan. It's contractual. So I'm in control. Now, yeah. Just one of the messages, Andrew, that I love for people to really get to sink in, whoever controls the money makes the money. So if you let the bank control the money, they're going to make the money.
Well, I mean, it's that old saying that, you know, to make money, you need to have money. And the whole concept is if you start out with money, you can, the building your cash generating assets is always going to be something that gives you value back right away. And you can find great cash generating assets, can't you? I mean, very easily, if you actually have the money to invest and know what the costs are.
You know, you can, and sometimes you don't even have to have money to get started, honestly, because there are a lot of people out there. I live in Florida, and one of the lessons that I've learned is, you know, how many people out there that are in their 70s, in their late 60s, in their early 80s, that have businesses, real estate portfolios, and all of these things that they just want someone, they're just ready to be done with it. They want to sell the business. They want an exit strategy. Yeah. Well, if you can give them a good exit strategy and you can give them good cash flow for the rest of their lives, better than if they took that money and put it in Wall Street, they're going to listen. And right. I've seen deals where they finance 100% of it. Now, I mean, that's harder. Okay. I'm not saying, I mean, those are deals are few and far between, but I have seen that deal. I've also seen somebody that says, hey, I really am passionate about this business. And people are looking for an exit strategy. If I could hire a 30-year-old or 35-year-old or 25-year-old that really wants to learn the business and then buy it from me over time, right? I'm very interested. Or they want to earn, or they're just going to be a partner and they're going to run it. And I'm just going to get part of the profit for the rest of my life. I'm good with that too. So there are so many opportunities. And you think about compared to what, Andrew? What we're told to do with our money is what? Put it in a 401k, qualified plan, right? Where the government tells you what your tax consequence is 20, 30, 40 years from now. Yeah, you should trust the government that everything's going to be fine. It goes into Wall Street, which you have no control over.
Yeah, exactly.
They report your earnings as a lie. They talk about average rates of return. Average means nothing. It has to be CAGR, compound annual growth rate, totally different than average rate of return. And they could change it anytime they want. And by the way, the whole time they're going to be inflating that dollar that you own. So you're going to put good dollars in, dollars that are worth more today. You're going to take them out when they're bad dollars. You're going to pay tax when you don't even control the tax rate or have any idea what it's going to be. I mean, if you think about it, Andrew, who would put money in something for 20, 30 years and not even know the tax consequences?
Most of America.
Most of America. And that's why most of America is still in the herd. And they're wondering why can't I get ahead? And what do they say? Every single person you talk about a 401k. Doesn't even seem like it's growing, right?
Yeah, you're basically just putting money into a savings account and just letting it sit there for the most part.
And so, I love what you just said there. So now let's think about what happens when you put money at the bank. You put money in the bank, and so you go down and you deposit money in the bank. And by the way, Andrew, when you deposit money at the bank, is that an asset or a liability for the bank?
Oh, for the bank, it's liability.
Liability, right. Andrew, yeah. You're in the top 1% because 99% of people say it's an asset because that's what we've been trained to think is deposits are assets. But it's a liability because the bank hasn't done anything with it. They have to give it back to you whenever you want it. And they have to give you a little bit of interest and they haven't earned anything. But the way they turn it into an asset is they loan it out to somebody else, right? And then that person pays interest to the bank and then they give you as little as you'll accept to use your money. Now, in 2016, I analyzed this for Bank of America. And Bank of America, their interest earned was 5.2%. Their interest expense was 0.2%. So now think about that. That means the bank is making 2,600% more than you, okay? Because our consumer brain says they're making 5.2, I'm making 0.2, they're just making 5%. That's okay, no big deal. No, that's not how a business works. A business works as the cost is divided into the profit. So my cost is 0.2% to pay the depositor, and I'm making 5.2. That's 26 times, 0.2 goes into 5.2, 26 times. So they're making 2,600% more than you with your money. Now, here's the twist. There's only one banking system in the world. So if you have money deposited at one bank and borrowed from a bank, they're making 2,600% more than you with your money from you. Who would do that if they realized? If you know what's happening, you'll know what to do. Don't do that.
And see, the question that comes to my mind that I would think people would ask you about your system is, well, what's the catch? When, man, there's a whole bunch of catches on that other side, more than you can imagine.
Yeah. Yeah. And here's the catch is in the beginning, it's not dollar for dollar. The first year you put in a dollar, you have less than a dollar to use with the insurance contract. But by year 10, okay, so we have to think long term. By the year and by the second, third, and fourth year, you're getting close or exceed even. It's right in that little, depending on your age, underwriting, and all of that. But by year 10, everybody is around this number. I put in a dollar, I have $1.50 to go put into something. Now think about that. Somebody else is using the bank. They put in a dollar, they go put a dollar in the real estate. I put in a dollar, I take $1.50, go put it in the real estate. And use somebody else's money to do it, OPM. Use and control. What does a bank want? Use and control of somebody else's money. So why don't we act like the bank? The bank is the most profitable business in the world. So let's run our families, run our lives like a business. And if we're going to run a business, let's make it the most profitable business in the world.
Yeah. So what lessons have you learned in your time doing this with other people that come to you for the help and building this out? What are some of the things that you have learned in the process of actually implementing this and doing it?
Yeah. So what I've learned is that you have to educate yourself on what you're going to, if you're going to do it actively, like if I'm going to go buy a business, I'm going to go buy a franchise. And there's all kinds of ways that you can help yourself become an expert in that area. Like if I go buy a franchise and I research it and I find something that has the FDD looks really good, which is a franchise disclosure document. And they're going to tell you all the good, bad, and ugly of the business. And here's what other people have experienced. But if I can go buy a business that I have an expertise in, let's say that I've been in the flooring business, I'm going to go buy a flooring business, right? Or I'm going to go buy a franchise and copy somebody else's success. Or I'm going to go buy real estate and I'm going to learn everything there is about real estate. Or here's the simple thing to do. Go find the most successful real estate investor in your area or take the top three, call them. Hey, I'd like to take you to lunch. I want to get into real estate. I want to learn from you. Would you mind spending a little bit of time with me? You spend a little bit of time with them, explain why you want to do it. And most successful people like that, if you ask them to mentor you, if you ask three people, I promise you, one of those will at least do a deal with you that will walk you through your first deal or two. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now you're getting an education. So that's what I've seen people do. In fact, I'll give you, Andrew, an example of a great young client who I think might be 36 now. Okay. Yeah. But 5 years ago or 6 years ago, he had less than $1 million of real estate. Now he has over $500-600 million of real estate, all within 75 miles of his hometown, which is a small town in Wisconsin. And the way that he did it is amazing, because he did exactly these things. Now that person, they use this system for their escrow. They put all the money that they hold for escrow into their insurance contract. When they need it, they pull it out. And as it comes in, they put it back into the insurance contract. And now think about that. At year 10, he's going to put in a dollar from the escrow and have $1.50 to go use. I win.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, absolutely. Now, I know, though, that there's a question that my audience is asking right now. How does this relate to books? Can books be a cash-generating asset? Can they be something that I'm looking at? You know, we're talking a lot about real estate, but what about actual personal branding? What about investing in myself?
Absolutely. If I can, if you take a book, let's say that I write a book and I'm gonna promote the book. The book's gonna make some. I'm gonna take the money. What I'm gonna do is all of the things that I need to do to promote the book. I'm gonna take a loan from the insurance company, and I'm gonna put into the book to produce the book, to promote the book. And then as the book makes money, I'm going to flow it back into the insurance contract. And then if my goal is to write a series of books or write a new book every 6 months, or, you know, the thing that I've kind of figured out is that for me, I want to have short books, more books, and I want to like evolve it as I go. So like I would love to write a book every 6 months, and I would then if you think about on that ledger, instead of it saying real estate project one, real estate project two, it's book one, book two, book three, book four, workshop five, you know, whatever it is, yeah. Because money has to reside somewhere. It has to flow. If water doesn't flow, it becomes stagnant. If blood doesn't flow through our bodies, we die. Motion is the law of God with money as well. Is money has to flow. So if it's flowing out into the book back as its prof, every profitability point, every cash flow, absolutely you can do it with the book all day long.
Yeah. And you can build out that book and to connect it into those other realms, those other avenues. I mean, like we're talking about you and the infinite banking concept and your business with that. But you also have a podcast. You're here on my podcast. You're going out to my audience. We're going out to yours. I'm sending you some of our authors to talk on yours. Yep. You know, these are all things that you built out from just starting out with those assets and building them from there.
Yeah. And what it is taking control of the your monetary system, right? Mm-hmm. And so once I take control, it's like anything else. If I put time and money into writing a book, then what's the purpose? Right. Yeah. And I have something to say, I have something to help people. And, you know, Zig Ziglar, and this, it took me 15 times to hear this before it sunk in, cause I was slow when I was in my 20s, is, you know, if you help enough people get what they want, you'll get what you want and more, right. Or you'll get more than you ever wanted. And so like when I think of, I've bought, using this concept, I've bought mining companies, I've bought logistics companies, I've bought any asset. Okay. So so a book is an asset. Everything, there's only two things, either instruments where we hold our money in like in Wall Street type of accounts or bank accounts because that currency is being debased every day, we're losing money every day. If I own assets, all the assets are going up in value during inflation. Mm-hmm. My rental, my multifamily real estate is going up in value. My rents are going up. The value of the book is going up. The cost of the book is going up, right? All of those things are going up. in inflation, but instruments go down because the dollars that are in those accounts are worth less every single day because of inflation.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And what are the mistakes people make? Because that's something that I think is going to be in somebody's mind. We've heard a lot about how you can do this successfully, but what mistakes do people make that get into this concept that do something wrong that you want to warn people against?
So I think it's really two things. One is they think of it like a life insurance policy. The life insurance policy is just where we hold the money. And the reason we do that is because of the loan provisions, the taxation, you know, all of that. There is death benefit. There is illness protection, like when you normally would go out and buy life insurance. But it's a place, it's because of the control that we get when we have the money there. And so don't look at it like you're buying death benefit. We make it the lowest death benefit, highest capitalization cash value that we can. Okay, so that's one mistake, is they're afraid to capitalize that because they see it as buying a life insurance contract or an expense. The second thing they do is they listen to companies like The Quiet Company and they leave it in there and they don't use it. Okay, so what I like to ask those people, and I do because we watch to see if people are using their policies, is those insurance companies, they're large financial institutions. What does every large financial institution in the world want? They want your money. How much of your money do they want?
All of it.
That's right. And how long do they want to keep it?
Forever.
And how much do they want to give back to you?
None.
Right. Okay. So that's a mistake. If you fall into their pretty marketing and their TV commercials and stay the course and all this stuff, mistake. Yeah. What we want to do is, hey, thank you very much for selling me that insurance contract. Now give me some of your money that so I can go make money with your money, just like a bank would make money with their depositors' money. And then they go, oh, wait a minute. And there are insurance companies out there that, Andrew, that say, I don't want you to do that. Don't be telling your clients to do that.
Yeah.
The client can do it, but their agent, their insurance agent, that's why you can't have an insurance agent set this up, because the insurance agent works for the insurance company. We represent all kinds of insurance companies, but we don't work for any of those insurance companies.
Yeah. So what are the key success drivers then when you're building something new like this? I mean, this is kind of a new industry. This is something that we haven't really talked about on this show before. So as an inventor, as someone that is a leading innovator, what are the things that actually drove your success in this?
Yeah, it's capitalizing and then managing the system. And what I mean by managing the system is, if I go buy a business, I have to make sure, I have to do, just like I was going to buy real estate or something else, I have to do good due diligence. I have to underwrite that investment carefully. I've got to see all the books. I can't fall in love. I have to have a system, right? The guy that I mentioned in Wisconsin, one of his criteria is, would it be okay if his grandmother lived in this property?
Yeah.
Okay. So I have to have my system. I can't vary from it. I got to stick to it and have discipline. So, like, I'll give you an example of a business that I bought in 2017. In 2017, there was this company that was kind of like eBay, but it was for big purchases. So they would qualify the buyer. They would say, okay, Andrew, you can buy up to $5 million worth of stuff, right? Because based on your qualification. But they had this little electronics refurbishment company that was part of their company that didn't fit in anything. So they get a $50 million VC infusion. And you know, when that happens, what are they going to try to do? They're going to try to sell that company in 3 to 5 years.
Yeah.
But you got this little company that, yeah, it's kind of a cool little company, but why is it there? It doesn't fit in their big overall picture. So they wanted to sell it, and they wanted $3.3 million for it. And I said, I'll give you $3.3 million for it on an earnout basis. So on the increase of over $16 million per quarter, whatever the increase, I'll pay you 20% of the increase over $16 million. after 2 years, because I need 2 years to get it up and running. Now, remember, they're going to sell it in 3 to 5 years.
Right.
And, but I wanted 100% earnout. And they said, well, you know, our board wants some money. We want $1 million. And I said, no. And so we settled on $75,000. Okay. And I also put in there that if they sold the business, which I knew they would in 3 to 5 years, mm-hmm. I don't owe them anything. I'm really just taking this off of the books. So then Andrew, so I borrow $75,000 from the insurance company. I pay them. I own the business now. I went into the business and I found inventory that they thought was old and worthless, but it was like sound bars that they had refurbished. But we figured out we could sell them for $34 to $38 a piece on Amazon, and we had zero in them. We made $400,000 by the end of the year. Okay, so then I asked people, I got a check, $400,000 at the end of the year distribution. What's my rate of return? They start to like take 75,000 divided into, and I go, wait a minute. That wasn't my 75,000. I was only paying 5% interest on 75,000 for 4 months. That's $3,750. I put in $3,750. I made 400 grand. Now I have nothing in that business. And it's a $3.3 million business. They sold it. They released the contingent liability of the 3.3. And I got that business for nothing. Right?
That was amazing.
Now, you don't have to do that too many times in your life to make a big impact.
Right.
Right?
Yeah, absolutely. So,
that's when it's fun. And I could give you story after story after story like that of a guy in Sioux City, Iowa, that has over 200 properties, and his wife is not a doctor anymore, and he's not a painting contractor anymore, because they started their infinite banking system and they took it and started buying properties. And they bought the first one they bought, it was 100% seller financed. So they still didn't have any money out of their pocket, and they used the money in the insurance contract to do the renovations.
That's incredible.
Yeah, it's so fun.
Yeah, I'm about to say it sounds like a fun business. It sounds like something that actually is kind of entertaining to be in. Yeah. Because when you actually have control, you're having more fun. When you actually know what you're doing with your own money and not relying on somebody else, you're taking the stress out of it a little bit there.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, and talk about taking the stress out. The thing that's funny, I was on an airplane on Monday, and the lady that was sitting next to me, we started talking, and she said, my son just graduated from Penn State. He's a financial planner, but he says that's a joke. Now, this is just what she said. She's like, hey, they just tell us what to tell people, and then we go out and we just repeat what they said. And I don't want to do this. I want to own real estate. So she said, I told him that he needs to do the first deal on his own. And I said, why would you do that? I mean, in Pennsylvania somewhere, he still lives in Pennsylvania. There's got to be somebody who owns real estate that knows how to do it. And you don't think that some guy like me, 58, or somebody 68, is going to share with this 22-year-old how to get started? I'm going to put my arm around him and say, look, let me help you on your first deal. I'll just help you. Let me just walk you through it. Why wouldn't I?
Yeah, I love that. Mentorship. I mean, that's what Leaders Press is all about. So as we kind of start winding down here, I always at the very end to kind of ask, you know, what's a golden nugget, something that is absolutely universally useful that you think that somebody can use? I mean, this whole podcast has been basically one great big one of those, but something we haven't covered, just something our audience can take away, a final thought that you want them to have.
Yeah. I mean, a final thought I would say, Andrew, is know where you are, figure out where you want to get to, but you got to have those 2 points. Right? If we're going to fly to Tokyo, okay, we decided we want to go to Tokyo, but if we haven't figured out where we're starting and really being honest with ourselves where we're starting, then we have no idea what the path should be between wherever we, if we're going to be in Southwest Florida to Tokyo, then great. But I got to know that I'm starting here. So like, what I mean by that is, what are my strengths? What are my weaknesses? and what do I like to do, what I not like to do, really analyze me and then get a clear vision of where you want to be and then get committed. Because and be relentless is being committed. You could be interested. Interested will get you nowhere. Committed will get you everywhere. Because once you make that decision, then you're in the exploration process. Once you jump in the river, it's not a decision of jumping in the river anymore. Now it's making sure you don't drown and you get down the river where you want to go.
Fantastic. Well, that is great information. Like I say, this whole thing has been awesome information. I can let you talk all day. I love doing practical stuff. But how can people find out more about you? How can our audience actually get to where you are and get engaged?
Yeah. So there's two ways. One, we have a website, createtailwind.com. Okay. The other way is we have a community where we you don't even have to talk to somebody. You can take free courses on there and learn about becoming your own banker. We'll even send you a free book if you mention Andrew's show. And here's how you get to the community. You can just search Create Tailwind on the Apple App Store or the Android App Store, or just simply go to community.createtailwind.com.
Excellent. All right, ladies and gentlemen, those links are going to be right there down below. Jim, like I say, we could talk all day on this, but yeah, let's just go ahead and follow those links and go talk to Jim. I appreciated having you on today. This was really great information for our audience.
Thank you for having me, Andrew. I really appreciate it.